Welcome to the Python demo session by Mind Magics. I will be the trainer for the session. Now coming about myself, I am having 5 years experience. All my experience is mainly into the Python and data engineering side. So on data engineering side, I have worked on big data technologies like Hadoop, Spark, mainly using Python, so PySpark you can say. Also, I have worked on Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, that data analysis side, and also I have worked on the Kafka, and I'm working on Scala as well. So mainly my expertise is into Python domain. About the course curriculum, what all things we are going to learn as a part of this course? So first of all, we will be going through an overview of Python. In this, we will be learning why Python, what is Python, why we need a language called Python, all those things. The features of Python, what is an interpreted language, how different an interpreted language is from a compiled language, what is the advantages and disadvantages. So we will be talking about the downloading installation, which version of Python is currently used in market, which versions we will be going to install, where to find the documentation and all those things. We are familiarized with Python and we have completed our installation. What we are going to do, the first thing is we are going to verify our installation. So we will be verifying with different mediums. So we will be using some IDs, we will be putting some hello world commands, hello world program, we will be seeing what is the output, if it is coming fine, is our installation successful. Then we will be learning to how we can run a Python script. Okay, so we will be writing some simple scripts in Python, we will run that and we will see. We will be running some Python scripts with some normal program. You don't have to worry about the program, we will be keeping the program simple because we have just started learning the technology. You might not know many of the things. So we will be keeping the script simple, just it will be like a practicing how to start a scripting in Python. Then after that, we will be starting up with the first thing, that is the data types and variables. So to work in any language, okay, not only Python, to work in any language, you have to know some fundamental things. That is how your computer interacts with your language, how the data is processed at the computer side. Those understanding really matters when you are properly doing something. Okay, that will increase your code performance, that will decrease your time complexity. Those things, understanding on those things is very important. So we'll be starting with the very basics. We'll be learning about what a variable is, what a data type is, why we need these things, where they are stored, and all those things in detail. We'll be talking about what are the string types, what is a normal string, what is a rock, and what is a Unicode string, the string operators, expressions, and then we will be talking about the arithmetic operators, so math operators and expressions, and then we have 6 other operators. We will be talking about all those operators in details, like assignment operators, the logical operators, bitwise operators, each and every operators. There are total 7 operators in Python, so we will be talking about all of the operators in detail. We will be learning about how to write to screen, how to do the first print statement. Okay, so writing to the screen we will be learning. Then we will be learning about the command line parameters. Then we will be learning about reading from the keyboard, so how to take input from the user during the runtime. So input can be taken by using a command line argument or reading from the keyboard. So we will be seeing both the methods. We will be talking about both the things, and we will be learning the relevant modules also for them. Once we are done with that, then we will be going with flow control thing. Okay, but before getting into flow control thing, I will be generally talking about all the sequences, the data types. So I will be talking about all the data types. So I will be talking about the list operations. I will be talking about the list methods. We'll be talking in details about the strings. We'll be talking about the slicing and indexing in string, which is a very, very, very important concept. Keep in mind, whenever you are working in any programming language, there are some data types which are very important to it, like strings, lists, and dictionaries. These 3 are very, very, very important data types, because most of the data will be coming in these 3 data types. And to work on this data, if you have a very good command, it's very, very, very easy to work on those data types in Python. So we have quick shortcuts, quick formulas to work on those data types. So we will be learning about those things. We will be seeing how to index a character or how to index an element from a list. We'll be learning about the slicing. We'll be learning about reversing. We'll be learning about all the list operations, string operations. We'll be learning about sets, dictionaries, and tuples as well. Once we'll cover till this portion, we'll be learning about all the data types available in Python, which are important, which have some manipulation required. We'll be learning all about them. We will be learning about the conditional statement. So that will be coming in under the flow control. We'll be starting with the conditional statement. What is if? What is else if? What is else? Why we need them? How to use them? What is a nested statement? We'll be learning about all those statements. Okay, we'll be talking about indentation, because in Python, the indentation is very, 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 very important. So we'll be talking about the indentation. Then we'll be talking about loops in Python. We have two different type of loops in Python, the for loop and the while loop. So we will be talking about both the loops in Python. We'll be talking about the statement, flow control statements like break and continue. We will be talking about the else statement in loop. So generally other programming languages won't have else statement supported in loop. We will be having the else statement in loops as well. We'll be learning about that as well. Then we'll be learning about the range function. What basically a range function? Once we'll complete this flow control portion, then we'll be going to defining the functions. One thing to note, Python provides you a flexibility to use your preferred way of coding. Python has two ways of coding, that is a functional approach and the object-oriented approach. We will be discussing shortly. Just to brief you here, you can use any of the approach. It totally depends on you or the client requirement. Okay, if client has given you a free hand, then it's on you which is your preferred way. You can use both the ways. We will be learning about the functions, and once you complete till this portion, starting from this portion to this portion, this will be suffice enough to start with the functional approach of Python. This will be suffice enough to start with the functional approach of Python. You can start writing the scripts, you can start the programming using the functional approach. This is the first section, the very, very first section where we will be talking mainly on the functional approach of the Python. The next sessions, we will be talking about files. So we will be working how to work on files using Python program. What a file is, how you will be opening a file, how you will be reading, writing, appending to a file. What all can be the formats of a file, what all datas can be there, different things. So we'll be learning about working with files. We will be learning in details about dictionaries. Okay, before the slides, when we'll cover till this portion, we will be aware of the flow control statements as well, that is the loops. So once we'll know about loops, then iterating over dictionaries, keys, dictionary values and dictionary items is easy. So we will be talking about again a bit of dictionaries and how we can handle dictionaries. And along with dictionaries, we will be talking about JSONs also. After that, we will be talking about errors and exception handling. What is an error and exception handling? No one can write a perfect program. Our program may lead to some error. That may be because of our program, that may be because of network, that may be because of IO. You don't know. Because of unwanted situations, some or the other things will be happening. You don't want your website or you don't want your program to crash. Even if something wrong happens in your program, you want the situation to be handled. In that case, we will be using this errors and exception handling. We will be using different blocks to write the program in such a way so that it will be automatically handled. Once an error occurs, it will be automatically handled by your program. So we'll be talking about those things inside the errors and exception handling. After that, we will be learning about modules. What basically a module is? Module is again a Python program only. Why we need a module? What is a module? Significance of import statements, how to import the modules, and all those things we'll be learning inside the module. We will be learning about the regular expression. Again, regular expression is a very, very, very important topic. So whenever if I'm emphasizing on some topic, then keep in mind that I am telling it to you from my own experience. You will be needing these things in your day-to-day activity. So regular expression, multiple times you will see some or the other situation is coming where you will think, okay, if I know the regular expression, I can handle this thing. Client may give you some random expectations, or your manager will have some random expectations from you. So this regular expression is very, very, very important if you want to do some nice thing. We'll be learning about regular expressions, and then we will be getting into object-oriented programming world. So in object-oriented programming world, we will be learning about what a class is, what an object is, all those things, what a constructor is, how the Python implements those things, what a destructor is, what is a class method, what is an instance method. All those things we'll be talking about. Then we'll be talking about the OOPs concepts. We'll be talking about abstraction. We'll be talking about encapsulation. We'll be talking about polymorphism. We'll be talking about inheritance. We'll be talking also we'll be talking about the things which are supported in Python, things which are not supported in Python, and how we can handle those things in Python. So we'll be talking about those concepts of OOPs in Python. And then we will be learning about some third party modules. So we, by this time, we will be already having an idea what a module is. So we'll be learning some nice third party modules. Okay, so there are thousands of third party modules. We'll be learning few. You should be knowing as a part of programming anyway. It again depends on your choice. What is the interested domain you want to move on? Anyway, these modules will be helpful in any of the things. So we will be already learning about the RE module, that is while implementing the regular expression. We'll be talking about the JSON module, which will be very, very important to handle the JSON data. Then we'll be learning about web scrapping module. We'll be learning about multi-threading module. Apart from these modules, there will be other modules which we will be using, like date module, system module, which we will be learning as a part of our course curriculum. That's an overview, just an overview of our syllabus which we are going to learn. At the end of this course, we'll be learning about the projects also. But let's first get into today's agenda. So as a part of this demo, what we are going to learn? First thing first, what a Python is and why we need a Python. So Python is not a new language. It was developed way back in 1991. Why it is trending so much now? Why not at that time? That time, people rarely used. So that time, Python was just used for as a scripting language. No one was knowing the power, the capability of Python as a programming language, as an application development language. That time it was just a scripting language. How Python transformed from scripting to a fully functional programming language? We'll be seeing that. In today's date, you can do anything using Python. Starting from development of a web application, mobile application, to working on any of the databases you can think of, to work on machine learning, data science, blockchain, whatever. Think of a technology. You want to work on big data, you have Python. You want to work on machine learning, you have Python. You want to work on natural language processing, you have Python. Whatever you want to work on, if you know Python, you can work in that domain. That's what is the power of Python. So if you know Python, at any point of time in your career, you can switch your expertise domain. So if you think, okay, now I have enough knowledge on this thing, let me try something else. You don't have to learn a different programming language. You will be simply using that particular module, that particular framework of Python, to work on that. That's a very nice feature of Python. That's why these all things became possible just because Python is, first of all, an open source programming language. The community, the developer community of Python is very, very, very vast. So they keep on putting the codes in the Python's library. Whatever technology comes in market, you will see sooner or later you will get an integration with Python. Either that technology itself will launch the integration for Python, or else the Python's community will give you a module or a framework or a library to work on that particular technology. So that never ever a Python programmer will be feeling left behind. He will never feel, oh, I could have worked in that thing if I would have known this language. No, you want to work on a particular thing, you will have some or the other way to work on that using Python. That's a very cool feature of Python. Python being an open source language, you can contribute, you can get the codes of Python, you can modify the codes of Python, you can do anything on Python. The second feature of Python is, it's an interpreted language. And being an interpreted language, in the beginning of the career of Python, it was misinterpreted as a scripting language only. So that time, the scripting language, so what basically is scripting language, and what basically is application programming language, borderline was a bit blur. So Python was mainly considered as a scripting language only. So that's what, today also, many people will think, okay, Python is a scripting language only. Okay, so people will be using it to either automate some stuffs, or they will be using on some network call and all. But no, you can write a full-fledged application. Instead, I am writing, that's what is my job. I am doing application development only. So entire framework development is done in Python. That's what, you can use a Python as a full-fledged application programming language. Python provides you the feature of both functional language and object-oriented language. When I talk about Python is an interpreted language, what in interpreted language mean? So let's go a bit towards, okay, this is Jupyter Notebook. I will explain you about this IDEs and installation as well. When I talk about the interpreted language, there are two things. An interpreted language, and the second thing is, computer understands only binaries. Apart from binaries, that is the zeros and ones, your computer doesn't understand anything. Maybe you are a Python programmer or a Java programmer or a C programmer, C++ programmer. Doesn't matter. Your computer simply understands binary. To make your computer understand, you have to convert your language. Okay, whatever you are writing is a high level language. You have to convert your high level language into a machine level code so that your computer understands that. Now, how that conversion will be done? That conversion will be done by some kind of software, either an interpreter or a compiler. So, some languages like Java, Scala, they are compiled languages. Languages, Python, are interpreted language. What is the difference? The difference is, when I talk about the compiled language, suppose I have 15 lines of code, okay? Okay, suppose I have some 15 line program. Firstly, we are talking about compiler. So, how compiler will be processing this program? You have written a program, 15 lines, you want to submit it to computer. So, once you submit this program, there will be two phases. The first phase will be a compilation phase. In the compilation phase, what you will be doing, your compiler will be reading your program from top to bottom. And each of the line will be read from left to right, and each of the line will be read from left to right. Okay, it will check for the syntax and the semantics of your program. So, did you wrote your program syntactically and semantically correct or not? If that particular line 1 is syntactically and semantically correct, it will go and check line 2. It will not do anything to line 1. It will simply check. If it is okay, it will go and check line 2. If there is error in line 1, it will stop execution. It will say, hey boss, there is some compilation error in your line 1. Please fix this. Now, if it is fine, it will go and check line 2. Again, if line 2 is fine, it will go and check line 3, line 4, line 5, so on. It will check all the 15 lines one by one. Now, once it has checked all these 15 lines one by one, what it is going to do? It is going to convert all these 15 lines of code in one go. All these 15 lines of code will be converted into an intermediate machine level code, that is byte code, in one go. But if you talk about interpreted language, how interpretation will happen? Again, you are submitting a Python language code or any high level language. Now, that being an interpreter, what is the duty of the interpreter? It has to convert your high level code into a machine level code. What it will be doing, suppose the same 15 line of code you are submitting to an interpreter, it will read line number 1. It will check whether line number 1 is syntactically and semantically correct or not. Once line number 1 is syntactically and semantically correct, it will execute line number 1 before going to line number 2. It will not wait for checking all the lines. It will not say, okay, first check all the 15 lines and then I will start executing. No. It will execute line number 1, then it will go and check line number 2. Again, line number 2 is correct, it will execute that. So, in interpreter, line by line execution will keep on happening. In interpreter, line by line execution will keep on happening. But ultimately, both of them will be giving you a code which is understandable by your computer. In case of Python also, after interpretation happens, it will give you a byte code which will be a platform independent code. Platform independent code means, so if I'm saying Python is platform independent, it doesn't mean that Python software is platform independent. No. Python software is completely platform dependent. When you are performing installation, you will be seeing you have a Python for Windows separately, you have a Python for Mac OS separately, and you have a Python for Unix separate. You don't have a same Python for all the Windows, for all the platforms. No. When I say it is a platform independent, it means the intermediate code which we get after the interpretation happens, that particular byte code is platform independent. So, that particular bytecode can run on Windows also, that particular bytecode can run on macOS also, that particular bytecode can run on Linux also. But again, there are some conditions. They should have the same versions of the Python, okay, or the version on which it was interpreted, the same version should be there on other systems also. There are some conditions, but yes, that particular bytecode is platform independent. You having the idea, when we say that Python is platform independent, what we basically mean. So, what all we have discussed? Python as an open source language, Python as an interpreted language. We have also seen Python as two approaches of programming. The approaches are functional approach of programming and object-oriented approach of programming. In functional approach, we will be having functions at a abstract level. So at most, at the highest level, we will have functions. We will be using functions to distribute our program, divide our program. We'll be writing functions, and then we'll be using those functions to execute our logic and all. In case of object-oriented language, we will be having our entire code inside classes, and we will be creating objects of those classes to get our things implemented. Now, you don't have any idea of classes and objects? No worry, we will be learning what a class is, what an object is. But still, let me give you an overview what a class is and what an object is. Class is basically a collection of something which tells you about the properties. It will have behavior, it will have state, but it will not have any identity. An object is a real-time instance of a class, which will have some identity also. Object will have state, behavior and identity, but a class will not have any identity. It will have just state and behavior. These are some technical terms. Try to understand the same class and same object in some layman's approach. Even if you don't know these things, if you don't understand this, okay, what is state, behavior and identity, let's try to understand in some simpler words. Suppose you go to school. At the gate of that school, you ask the watchman, call me a student. They'll think that, okay, you might be knowing someone. The first obvious question the watchman will be asking you is, which student, sir, or which student, ma'am? That school is full of students, but still he will be asking you which student, sir, which student, ma'am. Because when you talk about student is a student describes the properties of people going to school to learn something. They will have some behavior, they will have some properties, like a person enrolling in school as a student will have a name, class, roll number, class teacher, class monitor, address, phone number, multiple properties are there. So if a boy or girl enrolls in a school, he will have those properties. If you talk about student, you are talking about a collection, you are talking about a group. Each of the persons, each of the member of the group are having the same behavior. They have some behavior, they have state, but they don't exist in real time. Student doesn't exist in real time. In real time, some individual student exists. So if you ask him, okay, call me Ram, Jam, or Sita, Geeta, something like this, some student name, there might be a case that the watchman will call that person, that Ram, Sam, Sita, Geeta, that student, if that particular student is there in that school or not. Ram, Sam, or Sita, or Geeta, these are student only. They have all the properties of a student, but they are uniquely existing. When you talk about object, this Ram is uniquely existing. When you talk about student, you are just talking about the behavior. You are just talking about the properties. But when you talk about an object, you are talking about a person or a individual with those properties. That's what an object is. If you have a cookbook in which all the steps are written to bake a cake, if you are going through that cookbook, it doesn't mean that you have baked a cake. You just know all the steps to bake a cake. But until and unless you bake a cake yourself, you will not be able to eat. So the steps there are written as a blueprint to the way to prepare a cake. But that blueprint will not make you a cake. You have to actually bake it. So that baked cake which you actually bake is the object, which is a part of that cookbook, part of the steps, implementation of that step only. So an object is a real-time instance of a class which will have some identity. So we'll be discussing in detail about the class and the object. Then again, you can use the approach of Python, whichever approach you want to use, okay, either the functional approach or the object-oriented approach. Then comes again a very cool feature of Python called type-inferred language. What basically a type-inferred language is? Again, very cool feature. If you see any other programming, if you don't know any other programming language, it's cool, it's fine. If you know any other programming language, if you have worked on any programming language like Java or C, might be in your college or somewhere, then what you used to do? Suppose I need to store a value 5. What I will be doing? I will be doing like this. Int of A, I will be first initializing a variable A, and I will be telling that, hey boss, this A is going to be of integer data type, and then I will be writing A is equal to int of A, and then A is equal to 5. But in Python, you don't have to do. If you have declared A as integer, and instead of A is equal to 5, if you will write A is equal to something Python, you will be getting an error. The compiler will ask you, hey, you told that you will be storing integer to me, and now you are trying to store a string. Why this? So it will raise an error. In Python, you don't have to do any of this. If you want to store 5 to a variable A, simply you will be saying A is equal to 5. No issues. It's the duty of the interpreter to infer, to deduce the data type of the Python. It will be automatically inferred. If I'll execute it, and if I'll check type of A, it will be showing me integer. After some line of code, if I'll write A is equal to Python, it will not complain me. It will not say, hey boss, you have stored 5, that is an integer value in A, now you are trying to store a string. No, it will not complain. What it is going to do, it will simply store that A with string value, and now the type will become str. So that's what, again, cool feature of Python, but you have to be a bit careful. Why, I will tell you. So this is called type inferred language, okay, or dynamically typed language. In this, you don't have to define the data type of a variable. Also, you don't have to declare a variable beforehand. As and when you have to use a variable, you just declare it and use it. You assign the value. It's the interpreter who will be inferring the value of that variable. It's the interpreter who will be actually getting in the values of that variable. That's what is the property called type inferred language. Python is also a type inferred language. Let's go one step upward and let's see why we need this data type. Why? Why we need to tell that, okay, A is going to be of integer and in other languages, and why not in Python? Let's go a bit into the architecture of the system. What happens actually? When you say A is equal to 5 in Python, or when you say, suppose, let's say int of A, and then you say A is equal to 5 in Java or any other languages, what happens? All the execution happens in the main memory of it. Each and every execution processing will be happening in the main memory of your system. You have a program which is doing some computation, suppose adding two numbers. Then all the numbers in that program will be first stored to a memory location, in main memory. Now how much memory is required, that will be determined by the data type. So in case of addition of two numbers, we are knowing that the numbers can be integers or float. Accordingly, based on the data type, that much memory will be assigned in the main memory. We will be telling the interpreter, hey, A is going to be of integer data type. Please allocate that much of memory. So now the compiler will be talking to your RAM, and it will be asking, hey, give me the memory address to store 1 byte of memory value. It will be giving you some address, and at that particular address, you will be storing this 5. In Python, if you have asked for an integer space in Java or any other language, what it will do, suppose integer takes 1 byte, it will allocate 1 byte of memory. If you want to store string to that, string needs 2 bytes. And if you are pushing string to a variable which is having only 1 byte of memory, that will obviously raise you an error. That's why if you have declared a variable of integer data type and if you will try to insert string value, it will give you an error. In Python, that's not the case. In Python, they use dynamic memory allocation. As and when you will insert the value, accordingly we will allocate the memory. So now if you have 1 byte requirement, we will keep it 1 byte. If you will store some 2 bytes, we'll keep 2 bytes like that. So that is the funda of how the things work in the backend. So why we need the data types, what basically are data types, it will decide how much memory is required. Now let's talk about what is the scope of Python. Obviously, we are here, it means there we are seeing some scope. There is a lot of scope in Python. Currently, most of the people will say they know Python, but based on skill set, there are a lot many jobs, less number of resources. You can choose the scope according to you. I have already told you. If you know Python, you can once try in web designing also. You can try in machine learning also. You can do data analysis also. You can do data engineering also. Whatever you want to do. Depending on your choice, you have that scope in each and every domain of the market. Search for this Python keyword on any of the job portals. Naukri, LinkedIn, anywhere. You will see the results. Which requirement? Why they are looking for Python? Some people might need it for some Google Cloud or AWS programming. Some people might need it for Docker implementation or Kubernetes. Some people will be looking for Django and Flask development. Some people will be looking for Python developer for their machine learning algorithm. Take anything, any of the scope, you will be seeing there will be lot of jobs in Python. At this point, we have less number of resources which are skilled in Python and more opportunities in market. Now let's talk, once we learn the technology, what is the use of learning? We will be doing something, we will be creating something. So we will be working on two projects. The first project, okay, I'm just taking, to, let me describe about the two projects that any one of them can be first, any one of them can be second. So we will be talking about web scraping project. What web scraping is? Web scraping means, suppose you want, there is a website which is having data about something. That particular data is known as a beautiful table on that particular website, like suppose a Wikipedia. And it is telling you about the World Cup won by respective country in respective years. And the stats of each of the World Cup map. So you can see the data, but you can't download that Wikipedia page. And you can't do that screenshot option also, okay. Because again, if you are taking screenshot, so from that screenshot, you will not be able to extract any text. What if I will tell you, I have something for you, which will be, even you don't have to do anything, you will be just triggering your script, automatically it will go to that particular website, whatever data you want from that website, it will get it for you. That thing can be achieved by this web scraping. So we will be learning what a web scraping is, the modules required by web scraping, and we will be demonstrating a very good project. We'll be going to some website, we'll be scraping from the data from it, and we will try to analyze what data we are getting, why we are getting the data, what data we want. All those things we'll be doing in that project. The other project is we'll be working on database. We'll be taking any database, either MySQL or Oracle, Mongo, any other database. We'll be taking a database, and then using programming, we will be inserting, updating. We'll be performing all the CRUD operation on the database, and then again from that data, from the data set, we will be again doing some kind of analysis. So how to do insert a list of data, okay, how to do it record by record, how to get a list of data, how to do it record by record, now how to write it to a CSV file, and all those things we'll be seeing in that particular project. Be assured that after doing these two projects, you will be getting good amount of confidence to work in Python. And trust me, Python is very simple language to work on, very simple language to understand. You just need some guidance from me or anyone. You just need some guidance and then Python will automatically complete. Once you'll complete this course, a course completion certification will be provided you at the end of the course. Now after the project will be, project is done. And apart from this, this is not a hard and fixed syllabus. If you have some queries, like if you want to know something, if you have some doubt, anytime you can mail me, you can WhatsApp me, you can use our portals, you can connect to anyone and get back to us in case of any queries. Okay, if you want to learn something, like okay, you want me to include some particular topic, some particular module, we can do that anytime. And the course content which we have seen, that's not a hard and fast, okay, so that's just an overview of the things which we are going to learn. We'll be talking about the lab setup, so how we are going to proceed in our learning. Learning means you have to learn Python. To learn Python, you have to practice. What happens when someone teaches? Suppose if I'm delivering lecture, you are listening to it, I will tell you some tips and tricks. Okay, this is this how you will be reversing a string, or you are reversing a list, you are reversing an array. Cool, you will say, oh, this is very easy, you learned it that time. But if you will not practice that, trust me, you will forget that. Until and unless you will start hitting the keyboards, you will not get that confidence. Even if you think, okay, I know this thing, until unless you start hitting the keyboard, you will not learn that thing. Make sure that you dedicate some hours for practicing. You have to practice. Once you start practicing, you will be knowing about the syntax errors. You will be discovering a lot of things. You will be getting errors. You will be doing Google. While doing Google, you will be learning new concepts, new things. Might be my way of programming is different. Some other programmer has done the same program in a different approach, and his approach you like more. It may happen. I'm not saying that, okay, I'm the only person who can teach you better. But everyone has their own style. So some persons think you can understand. While you are exploring for something, you will be learning two more things. So you have to practice. Once you practice, where you will practice? you need some environment. For Python, it's just a free software. We will be going through the installation phase. We can either install it from the Python's official website, or we can install it from the Anaconda. Anaconda is a distributor of Python, scientific distributor of Python. And once we have our Python, we will be getting some IDEs, either Jupyter Notebook or PyCharm. I will be explaining you which IDE features what. On that IDE, you will have to practice. At the end of the course, each classes, the recording will be shared to you by MindMagic. The class notes, I will be sharing you. I will be telling you the link where you can practice and all. Session videos will be provided to you by MindMagic. All the documentation, I will be telling you where to find the documentation. How to get the documentation while programming. All those things we'll be knowing. You will be getting help to make sample resumes. A person will be guiding you in resume preparation. Useful references, I will be telling you. The class notes, I will be providing you. So if you have any questions regarding the demo, feel free to contact us. You can write us. You can connect with any one of us. And we will be expecting your feedback. You guys soon. Thanks.